One of the great responsibilities that we have is to tell boys and girls, men and women, why the narrow way. Why the narrow way? Scripture points out that there are two roads. On the one hand, there is a broad road. And on the other hand, the scripture says that there is a narrow road. Two different roads that cannot be traveled at the same time together. The people of the world and the young people of our times and our city are anxious to try to travel both roads. The broad, narrow road is the desire of most people. At times we want to be broad, at times we want to be narrow, so we want a road that's broad and narrow. But the scripture plainly suggests that there are two roads leading in two different directions, ending in two different destinations. And Jesus, the one who knows more about life than anyone who has ever lived, because he was the giver of life, says that we should travel the narrow road. Now, first of all, let us look at the fact that there is a broad road. And let us admit that there are some things about the broad road that just have natural attractiveness about it. First of all, it's broad. You don't have to aim at going to hell. You don't have to decide to go to hell. You don't have to figure out how to go to hell. It's a broad road. The broad road needs no discipline. The broad road requires no girding of yourself. The broad road requires no training and pulling in and rebuking of yourselves. The broad road is just broad, without aiming, without intending, without trying to get on the broad road. You can just wobble on. It's a broad road. And that within itself is attractive, because we're living in an age where people despise disciplines. They despise the idea of the do's and the don'ts. They despise the idea, even in our appearance and even in our dress and manner. It is no accident that in recent years there are people who conduct themselves, even from a standpoint of grooming, that you're confused as to who you're looking at when you're looking at them. But we're living in an age now that nobody likes disciplines. Nobody wants rules and regulations. Nobody wants do's and don'ts. The broader it is, the better it is. And yet you have to watch that broad concept. But that is one of the attractive things about the broad road. It's broad. Do your own thing, whatever your own thing is welcome down the broad road. And there is another attraction about the broad road that is seen in this passage of scripture, and that is that there are a lot of people who travel the broad road. It is broad, and there are a lot of people. There's company. You can always find a crowd to help you do what you ought not do. The broad road is there. You can always find the crowd. If it's wrong, if it ought not be done, if it's something that shouldn't be done, if it's something against the will of God, you can find a crowd suggesting that that's exactly what we ought to do. And most of them are always fortified with all of the reasons why the foolish rule shouldn't have been made in the first place. So the broad road is a road of company. The broad road is a road that does not require the kind of disciplines that's being advocated here at this particular seminary. It doesn't require that. And there are many broad road travelers. There are many travelers down the broad road, yea, in our seminaries and universities and Bible colleges today. There are even broad churches. There are churches that does not require that we believe in what they would consider such outmoded doctrines as the virgin birth, such as the divinity of our Christ. They have gotten so now that there is no longer no heaven in the sky, no hell in the earth, no God to fear, and they have crucified Christ again and deified man. They are broad. It's broad. Whatever you want is down the broad road. You can find preachers who are preaching that Jesus didn't die, that he was not given of the Father. It's a broad road. But it appears to me, being a country preacher, that whenever you get on any road, you ought to have an idea about where you're going. But the most logical thing is, before you get on any road, you check not the condition of the highway, not whether it has chug hole, not whether it's 6-lane or 2-lane, but the first thing you do is decide where you want to end up. Where do you want to go? And it is illogical to be on a freeway marked clearly San Francisco, praying to the Lord that he would get you to San Diego. A good suggestion would be to turn around. A good suggestion would be, because the freeway that is marked San Francisco, more than likely, without scarcely a mistake, if you keep on it, will end in San Francisco. And there are a lot of young people all over this country who are riding on the highway of destruction. They're riding on the highway of immorality and all the other vices that are clearly marked destructive, but who are daily praying, Lord, deliver me from destruction. And a good suggestion is to turn around. So as we begin to select what road we're going to travel on, we don't necessarily look at the condition of the road or the condition of the highway, the narrowness of the road or the wideness of the road, as much as we decide where do we want to be when we get through traveling. And so Jesus said, there's something that I ought to tell you about the broad road, and that is, it's broad, it does not require a lot of disciplines. It has a crowd, you're not lonely, but it leads to destruction. It leads to destruction. Broad road, most of all, is a road that has no service station on. When you break down on the broad road, when the broad road has squeezed out of you every drop of life and vitality and attractiveness and goodness and spirituality and moralness, the broad road has a way of just pushing you off to the side. That it has a tendency of taking all from you. But when you break down, you're down. Somebody just pushes the old wreck aside and looks for somebody else who's ready to travel the broad road. Jesus said there's an alternative to the broad road. That there is another road that you can take. But he said, now I won't tell you, it's narrow. So you have to aim at it. Even the gate is narrow. You have to aim at it. It requires a conviction. It requires a determination that I'm going to enter upon the broad road. It requires a decision. It requires a commitment, an open commitment made unashamed. Jesus says, now I warn you, it's narrow. And in relationship to secular society, its concepts are narrow, its theology is narrow, everything is narrow about it with those who are trying to justify themselves of going the broad road. It's narrow. It has a lot of do's and don'ts. It has a book called the Bible that's constantly digging up and digging out and regulating. It's a narrow way. And then he says something that I can testify from my own experience. He says, don't many people travel? Few. Just now and then you'll find travelers. So in relationship to other human beings, it's a lonely road. It's a lonely road. It's a lonely road. I've experienced in my own ministry the loneliness, relationship to other people, of the narrow road. There are moments when you're lonely. It requires disciplines. It requires that you aim at it. It requires that you have a made-up mind. But he says something else about this narrow way. He said, but it leadeth, and that's the important thing, it leadeth to life, and life everlasting. So as I stand before the broad and the narrow road, I must take under consideration not only the convenience of the road, but I must take under consideration the ultimate end as to where I'm going. From my own experience as a pastor, make an observation of the narrow road. It has on it a service station. And somehow or another, people who travel the narrow road have breakdowns, but they're never forsaken. And somehow or another, when you're on the narrow road and you break down and you have a calamity, if you keep headed in the right direction, if you call him, he'll answer. And on the narrow road, he restoreth soul. He prepares tables. He revises us again. He giveth strength. Faint, he giveth strength. That's a service of the narrow road. So it is narrow. It is lonely. But the narrow road has a companion who travels it, who's listening and looking and watching for those who don't have enough strength to make it from day to day. And so he restoreth us. He reneweth us from day to day. And so I travel the narrow road. And I bid you come. And as you travel, whatever thou dost need, thy God will supply. And one of these days, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that's gonna be.
I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, saith the Lord, which is and which was and which is to come, the Almighty. He which testifieth these things saith, surely I come quickly. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus.